All right. Can you hear me okay? Okay, good afternoon. Thank you. Is this the right after lunch session? Is it? Oh boy. So that's why they gave you a screen like that to lay back and, you know, watch there. Just don't drool, okay? So thank you for coming today. We have 1 hour to cover probably the biggest feature in Denali. Of course, that's a very partial view, but that's what I believe. Today we're going to go through and discuss how we build a mission-critical system with high availability using always-on. How many of you have heard always-on term? How many of you know what is always-on? Okay, fewer hands. That's good. So you're in the right session. I have a demo which I hope is going to take the biggest part of the session. I'm connecting to one of our big servers in Redmond over internet here, so we're hoping the link will stay on for an hour. What's that? Yeah, no, everything is always on. So let me go through the items that we need to discuss first, and then I'll go through the demo. By the way, I have some nice giveaways here to keep you awake. I have some shirts, some USBs, and some secret envelopes, 3 envelopes. So there'll be some questions on the way, like what's my name? There you are. So let's take a little a retrospective. Let's look a little back what's happening with Always On. Today, SQL Server has a number of high availability choices. You have log shipping, you have replication and a few flavors of those. You have mirroring and a few flavors of those. And then you have clustering. So no lack of choices. And sometimes when you try to put things together, not necessarily they all fit together to meet your high availability or disaster recovery choices. Okay? Sometimes you need 5 nines high availability. Sometimes you like 3 nines or 2 nines disaster recovery sites. And sometimes the technologies don't fit very well together. We have several key enterprise customers that have been very successful today using a combination of those technologies, namely Dell, Hewlett-Packard, Bigwin. Bigwin is a big betting organization in Europe. ServiceU, that's a credit card company. Care Group, for example, it's a big health organization in the U.S. But the solutions remain fragmented. That's the bottom line. And they don't have many flexibility points. So wouldn't it be nice to kind of get all these technologies together in a single offering, and based on your needs, you determine what level of availability you need to establish, and then the technology and the wizards and SQL takes care of all the plumbing and the setup. That's in simple terms what Always On tries to put all this thing together to give you a simpler way to set up your process. So mission critical needs that we see is mostly how you plan, how you manage a planned or an unplanned maintenance window, how do you control the patching, how do you control the online operations, you have failover requirements, hardware usage, and of course nothing stops how you plan for the future, how you enhance your cluster. You need more capacity, more sites, more servers. You want an environment where easily you can flex your system to accommodate new servers or new data centers potentially. So the mission critical availability, as far as our goal, is to be integrated, flexible, and efficient. That's the main goal. So we wanted to have a unified and simplified solution, and typically that Microsoft Word translates in a very nice wizard that you go through and the system generates some script which you'll never see. I mean, how many of you are using wizard to generate script? Okay, then you're the unique group that does that. But that's good. So we want to create a simplified solution, easy to deploy and manage as well. As far as flexibility, we wanted to give you an ability to reuse existing investment. Companies, they do a lot of hardware investment to support high availability or disaster recovery environments. They have sometimes a parallel data center sitting there, idle potentially, just in case we ever need it. But with today's technologies, most of this investment sits idle exactly. It doesn't participate in anything, doesn't give you much value back. It's just an insurance there. So we try to find ways to enhance this usage and give you more return to your investments, and we'll see how. I want it to be more efficient as well. We want to be more cost effective to utilize the hardware, the high availability hardware, and give you different options. Today in the clustering world, clustering implies very strict list of hardware certified, and you have a very expensive shared SAN storage. So clustering is not necessarily cost efficient. It's an expensive solution. And then, as far as efficiency, we want to improve IT efficiency. Clustering is getting better, but it's not an easy thing sometimes to manage or set up or configure. So how do we make this configuration easier so IT is not there just to set up the cluster, but is more there to manage and see any potential pressure points in the cluster to see how we can manage the resources better. So these were the main three themes: integrated system, flexible, and efficient. So we came on with this always-on solution, and I'm glad we changed the name. Did you guys work with early builds of Denali? We had a different name. Do you know the original name of that? There you are. Repeat. Did you hear the guy? Hadron. So make sure you know how you spell it. The gentleman just received an 8 gigabyte USB drive. So keep awake. All right, so what we're doing in Denali, we're separating 100% the clustering from the SQL high availability. Before, it was kind of mixed. You had to create all these resource groups, if you remember, the IP name, the disk. It was kind of convoluted between Windows and SQL. Today in Denali, it's 100% isolated. So you would expect a Windows admin to set up the cluster first and for all. Always on needs cluster. It sits on a cluster that is managed 100% by Windows. So Windows takes care which servers belong to the cluster and manages the failover and the failback and all this story. After the cluster is generated, then SQL is installed on this cluster, and then through mirroring, primarily, mirroring establishes how the data is kept in sync in the cluster. Okay? So we have the concept now in SQL of availability group. In mirroring today, you mirror one database. One database is mirrored there. One primary, one target. That's it. How about if your application needs three databases together and only one of the databases fails over and the other two is in the primary? That's kind of a problem. So availability group, it's a very nice thing because it groups the databases. It says all these three databases, it's one unit, they're going to fail over together or fail back together. So keep that term. You keep hearing that from us. Availability group. It's a number of databases. We support multiple secondaries. We support up to three secondaries. One primary, three secondaries, for a total of four servers in the cluster. These secondaries can be active. That is the exciting part. A secondary can be readable, real time, and you can backup from a secondary. Oh. Talking for using your HADR systems. So the question is, if you back up on the secondary, will it truncate your log in your primary? The answer is no. There are still two logs. When actually the mirroring is done on the log level, not actually on the database level. So when the transaction commits on log A, then it hardens on log B, and that's it. And then log B has to put it over here. So there is a few milliseconds potentially lagging, but no, two independent logs. So that's how it is anyhow. No, it does not. They are totally independent, yes, 100%. I will talk a little more for the impact on that. Because actually another interesting question is, if you read from the secondary, how the application of new data affects the secondary? Because I'm reading, it's active. So we're using by default database snapshot isolation on the secondary too. So, because there is only one writer there, the log. So readers do not block the writer. It's isolated. I wanted to throw you something, but I'm going to hurt people. So I owe you a USB. Come back later. Okay, as far as the cluster, and of course we haven't given up on the physical cluster. So the cluster, the traditional cluster we have, multi-site clustering. What was the big obstacle before to do multi-site clustering? Distance is always a problem. We can't avoid that. Latency? Yes, because you cannot go too far. I'm not looking for that. In Windows. I'm sorry? No, let me go to where I am because the time is short. All these are very good points, and these need to be considered. That's a licensing issue. the biggest problem before to do a proper multi-site clustering was because we were requiring all the sites to be on the same network, on the same subnet. There was a physical problem. You can pay more money, you can go closer, you can do things. But the actual requirement from Windows was all the servers to be on the same subnet. Now we don't require that anymore. Every cluster node can be on a separate subnet. So then you say, why even share anything? I'm going to have four servers having server and disk, server this, server this, server disk, and spread them around the world, and things are happy. So good stuff. Improved flexible failover policy. That's another big thing a lot of DBAs and administrators have asked. Give me more control on establishing more granular rules when a failover is to occur. So we exposing about 20 different rules is not yet flexible to the level where you develop a rule, but you can choose a whole list of rules to be much more granular. We're planning to expose more kind of a API level where you can program additional rules on yourself, but not yet. Okay, so let me move forward to more details of those. So as I said, we're supporting up to four secondaries. Two of them can be synchronous, and the other one can be asynchronous. So imagine you can have two synchronous and where the distance comes in place. When we say synchronous, just to give you from my experience, everything over 40 kilometers apart introduces very high latency to your synchronous. There is some math with light speed and all that it curves highly like that. And we can have one automatic failover pair. If you ever work with mirroring, we don't require witness server anymore to do failover automatic. So the four servers that are participating in your cluster can determine who's going to pick up. We have built-in compression and encryption of the data that moves across the servers, of course. And we're supporting both automatic and manual failover. A feature we even enhanced even more, having, especially since we can support up to two synchronous secondaries, automatic page repair of the principal. So if you have a synchronous mirroring and your primary faces a page corruption, SQL will retrieve it from one of the mirrors and bring the data forward. This is a hardware level page compression that it may detect. Integrated, this is what I'm going to demo, which is very, very exciting because the application now can connect using a virtual name. These four servers, they're going to receive an endpoint that it has a name, and this is a new connection software actually we developed. The code name used to be Medusa, you know, the head with multiple snakes and all that. No. Well, when you create the name, yes, it has a port and it has a virtual IP address as well. But you're connecting just by the name. Yes. In your application, you don't know for ports. I'll show you. And the beauty with this name is, you'll see when I do the demo, you can this name can be used for read-write connections or read-only connections. So in both cases, you connect it to the same virtual name, but we have a new extension in the connection string. It's called application intent. So if you put the intention of the application is read-only, it's going to go to this virtual name and see which server is readable only. That one. Okay, I'm going to read from here. When the read-write is going to go to the server that is for read-write operations. I'll show you in the demo to get a better feeling, but the idea is one connection from all your applications. When things failing over, blah, blah, the applications will recognize where they need to read from, where they can write to. It's very transparent to the application. We have a dashboard. I talked already for the wizard. We have a dashboard to show you the health of your cluster, how it's behaving, how it's working. It's a very nice dashboard through SSMS. We have system center integration. As you may have seen, we keep adding or we're publishing more and more packages or package for system center 2007. We have some for Azure, I know, that we monitor Azure. But this one gets also system center integration to see the health, the behavior of your cluster. If you care, we support file stream replication as well in the always on. So if you have big data volumes in documents using file stream, this can be replicated in an always on scenario as well. As far as efficiency, as we said, we try to use more of your hardware and we do readable secondary, backup secondary, and I'll show you some of the PowerShell scripts. I would say most or all of the function of always on can be scripted in a PowerShell script, so you can do a lot of this management through that. So you see a lot of work is happening. A lot of work is happening to combine database mirroring and log shipping and clustering in a good, very good cohesive environment. And we, of course, we want this to be managed by SSMS and maybe some PowerShell scripts, but SSMS is the main way to work on this infrastructure. So this is just a little visualization of what's going on, what you can do. You can have different scenarios, as we said. You can set up two servers on the left side, two actives, and then you can have asynchronous, as you see, or asynchronous remotely. You're setting up a high availability and a disaster recovery situation. You can have shared storage. You can have direct at start storage. The point is you can have a combination, a nice combination of options to get the best availability. Now, of course, each server, like the one on the right, you can have some of the nodes also additionally clustered locally to enhance the availability. They're not going to be part of the always-on scenario, but you can do a local cluster to improve their high availability as well. Okay? So for mission-critical requirements, typically we're getting this kind of scenarios. You may want zero data loss because it's so critical to you. You cannot afford any data loss. The other is fast application recovery. When the system switches over, fails over or fails back, we want to recover very quickly. And mirroring is the fastest way to recover today, even over clustering. Clustering can sometimes wait, you can wait for minutes to switch over. Because when you switch over in clustering, what happens? Why it takes minutes? That deserves an envelope, by the way. Why? And why that takes 3 minutes? No, that's not why it takes 3 minutes. That's an envelope. I'm more strict now.
Recover the logs.
Recover the logs. Because, by the way, what is in here, you may say, is not my picture, is $50 gift voucher to Westfield. Thank you, sir. So the answer is, it takes 3 minutes because it has to recover the logs. If it's a long transactions, if you ever see the SQL log, you'll see recovering, can take minutes and minutes and minutes to do that. When if you have log shipping with full sync, there's no lag, maybe one or two transactions potentially. Where are you? I don't see you. Ah, there you are. I'm sorry. Come again?
So zero data loss, does that mean that midstream transactions get carried over?
No. Zero data loss in this concept means whatever is persisted on the primary server is persisted also across in the replicas.
Not really zero.
In that concept, 99.999. I may have to rephrase that, you're right. Zero data loss as long as persisted in the primary one. The one on the fly, no, those they're not going to roll. Unless the application is tolerant enough, unless the application using that new connector we have, it retries, then it will go to the right place. Yeah, because the application, that's why we did this connector, the application will receive a notification that the server is switching over. And they can retry to apply that. Yeah? Yeah. It depends on your application, I would say. Yeah. Okay, let me move on. So we can establish, as we said, the redundancy across three data centers today. You may say, why three and not 30? Because we had time to test only three. I mean, there's no hard limit. But that's what we support from the system now, up to three, because we tested it. Application databases and dependencies fail over together. We have a new concept of a database in Denali. It's called contained database. What is your biggest problem today when you back up a database on server A and you restore it on server B? I'm sorry? One is that?
Users.
Your logins stay where? Behind. They don't go anywhere. Lovely shirt. So when we do a contained database, the contained database includes the objects related to the, there you are, thank you, related to the database. Now, you would need to enable that. It's one of the properties of SQL Server. It's kind of a security issue. So one of the properties now in the new properties in Denali is you have to enable to accept contained databases. So that allows you, when you back up the contained database, it gathers all the objects related to it, and then when you restore it, it has everything it needs. Today is only logins. We're working hard, maybe, I don't know when exactly, but soon, to have also the jobs, the SQL agent jobs that are related to that database. But the jobs are kind of tricky because they may relate to many databases. So we'll see.
How flexible is that? Because if I'm restoring to development, I don't want to have those users necessarily restored. If I take production and restore on development, I don't want my production users.
Then you don't use the contained database.
That's
a separate course. Yeah. Because then you can use SSIS, for example. SSIS has a task to move the logins as well as a separate one. Yeah. All right, let me see. Nice pictures. So today what you can do for the high zero data loss, you can have database mirroring with automatic failover, and then you can have log shipping for disaster recovery. So how's this availability group works? So there is a concept of availability group listener. This is the point, the virtual name I was telling you, that the application uses to know where to connect seamlessly, even if you have a failover. So instead of keep changing the DNS names or changing the connection string, you don't have to do that anymore. The system itself will take care of that. So let's say over here we have a primary server that has an availability group for HR, has two database, or one database in my case, and then we have a virtual name called HRVNN. So this server dies, application retries. The database now, since the primary failed, one of the secondaries, and I'll show you how you determine a particular order and a particular policy, server B becomes the primary, server C becomes the secondary at this stage, and the virtual name is available again in the primary. The virtual name is available to all the servers. So when the application retries, I mean, they keep using the listener that it says, you know, the HR virtual name is going to detect which one is the primary, which one is the secondary, and connect accordingly. So I already told you about the CDB. That's the contained database again. And this is trying, in a way, to establish a boundary between application and server. We kind of have today that with a, you can create, from Visual Studio, you can combine the data, the DDL, the data, the objects all together and have them as a deployment unit. But having it as a CDB, as a database that contains everything, gives you more flexibility, especially when you back up, you restore your system. All right, so CDB can be part of an availability group. So it can be replicated, it can fail over through that, and the authentication information moves with the CDB. So everything as far as logins, authentication, passwords, all these things they're going through. Of course, the best practice over here is to use a Windows integrated security, so you don't have to worry for passwords moving over. As I said, jobs, they're not there yet. That's a limitation, but we are working actively to see how we can move the jobs within the database.
I'm sorry, going back to the listeners, is there a best practice regarding the listeners? I mean, do you need to set up multiple listeners?
No. So the question is, do you need to set up multiple listeners? You're going to set up one listener for your whole cluster. And this, in the listener, when you set up the listener, you'll set up within this cluster, identify which server is the primary, which server is the secondary. So when you connect using the listener, you'll connect to the right intention. If you connect to a primary, you do read-write over there.
I guess my question is, what happens when the listener fails?
No, the listener cannot fail. Every server has a copy of the listener. So it's propagated. It's like a virtual name. It's attached to a port, attached to an IP address. Yeah, the listener is a class. I mean, if the cluster goes down, everything, then, okay, you don't have a listener anymore. So the question is, I mean, to paraphrase it, I mean, can you have multiple instances participating in a cluster?
Yes.
Or no? The cluster implies physical or virtual machines participating in a cluster. So you're clustering machines, not instances. If you want instance-level high availability, you look in maybe the traditional mirroring or log shipping or any of those. But if you want always on to participate in this primary, secondary failover, that's on the machine level, not on an instance level. Yeah. I'll show you the example and you'll see how it looks like. So the question is, if there is a performance impact, if the primary goes down and the secondary is about to pick up, now, there is a timeout, of course, engaged over here. So if there is a performance, if it sees the primary is down, there is a ping kind of process. Are you alive? And then it's going to say, no, I'm not alive. That's actually not on a SQL level. That's on a Windows level. So the Windows clustering will detect this node is down. It's going to bring up this node. So SQL, when it's trying to connect over here, immediately it's going to take, I'm down. I'm not available. It's not going to wait. then based on the topology you have, it's going to go to the next primary and connect over there. So it's very fast.
So once you're on the other primary,
yes? Well, the question is if you allow, this is up to you, if you allow automatic fail back, which it, most best practices don't suggest that. I wouldn't automatically fail back because your old primary will be behind, for sure, even for something. So that is the one of the other options. You know, you, I would suggest you do manual fail back. You know, make sure that you can see that from the dashboard when, because it's going to be in a synchronized mode. When it becomes synchronized, then you can initiate manual failback. That's fast. Okay. I want to make sure I have time for the demo. So this is Windows Server failover cluster. That's how the infrastructure works, as we said, in Always On. And we have active log synchronizations. It's always on the log level. Log from server A synchronized with the log of the server B. If it's synchronous, it's going to wait for both transactions to commit on the log. If it's asynchronous, it does not. It will persist on the server A, and then asynchronously is going to go on server B. What else do we have here? Of course, we support Hyper-V. We're supporting Exchange into that. This is mostly for the Windows clustering services. Bam. Yeah, you read that. So this is where we make it secondary readable, as we're saying. Today, mirroring can be readable as well. Let's be fair what we have today. But today, to make a SQL Server mirroring readable, what do you have to do?
Snapshots.
But you already got one. Who said the other snapshot? Okay. I'll give you a shirt. Snapshot. You have to create a database snapshot which is not light or real time because it's going to be snapshot at the time you take the snapshot and then it's going to grow very large because every time you're querying the snapshot, it's going to go back to the mirror and fetch the data and do all that. And then if you need more recent data, you have to drop that snapshot, create a new snapshot, very heavy. Today, we allow live connection to the secondary. Readable, fully readable, and I said we're establishing snapshot isolation, so none of the readers will block the writer, which is the log writer. Yes, sir?
Do you need a license?
Yes. The question is, do you need a license for that? Why are you asking me this stuff? Of course you need a license. I should bring my licensing guys with me next time. So let me put the official spin to that. The expected is that you need a license for that, yes. Of course, if you have, so if you don't read the secondary, like today mirroring acts as a passive, then you don't need a license for that. But if you make it active, either backups or reading or any of those, I mean, of course, it needs a license. But I don't, depending on your licensing, though, if you're doing on the user level, there's no users related here. It's only the SQL Server license you need, the actual EX server, which is not that expensive. All right. So there is a nice failover. They're switching roles, those two. Now, when they're switching roles, you see another thing you can put in your policy is that they switch roles because the primary failed. The previous primary now becomes available, and it becomes the secondary. And if you have synchronous, eventually that secondary, or the old primary, will catch up with the new primary. And you can stay with that if you like, and everything is happy. Because as far as your applications are concerned, there is a secondary, there is a primary. Reports continue, read-write continues, everything is happy. The tricky part would be if you actually lose the secondary 100% and you know, just caught fire or something, and you have only one primary left. Where is your secondary now? There's no secondary anymore. You have only one primary sitting over there. So this is where we're kind of debating today. What do we do with the read-only queries? Do we send them on the primary? But that's not your intent. You didn't want primary to serve any queries. I'm not saying we have a solution. We're kind of discussing it these days in the product team. What do you think we should do? What do you think, what would be a desirable reaction? Not allow read-only queries anymore at all? Or allow them? Or what? So the okay, I like the configurable approach, but I'm a live system. The system dies. What should I do real time? Stop? Don't allow read only? Allow them? How many want them to allow them? Okay, very scientific. How many do not allow? Wow. It's almost the same number. This side likes it. This is must be the conservative side. I'm sorry, there was a comment?
What about the replication of the primary?
There's no secondary anymore. It's only one primary left. No, no, it cannot be on itself. Of course, the log is getting bigger now, because it doesn't know where to go. That's the normal problem even today. When your replication or your mirroring drops, your logs keep growing. But that's not my question. I mean, we can figure that out. So that's our dilemma now. I mean, what do we do with the read-only connections? Do I stop them or do I allow them? No, there's no guarantee that the two servers will be the same spec. So the conservative approach, of course, is to not allow read-only queries, raise some error or some message or whatever, and then have some manual configuration done. You don't like that? Bad idea. No, no. The read-write still continues. Right.
The read only is used for control data.
Right.
Now, if you kill that secondary, your read only connection is now.
If they're using two connections, you're saying. Sneaky. Okay. That's a good. Yeah. Okay. So anyhow, by the time we ship it, we'll figure it out. But this is, you see, it's a little tricky. What do you do there? I'm sure we'll resolve it. Okay, so the backups as well is a nice thing as well. We allow you to backup from the replica. You can create backups on that. And then, of course, we have the logs as a single log of change. So you can restore from the secondary to the primary, if you like, and apply the logs as well. And then the chain is maintained over there. And you can use even Database Recovery Advisor. There is a wizard that makes the restore simple. It looks at the backup files and the chain and all that and guarantees everything works well. I think this backup story is quite exciting because you can offload all your backups, DBCCs, all the storage, the checkups. Works quite well over there. But that implies, again, the secondary becomes active, which means you have to pay for that. That's okay. Seamless demo, good. All right, let's think if this is alive. It's alive. So because we're all excited with hardware people, this is one of our latest servers I just got last week. Look at this task manager. Who can tell me how much memory I have? It's here. A lot of zeros, huh? 1 terabyte. That's a true 1 terabyte. Actually, this is 80 cores, but it's 80 threads. It's the new 10-core chip from Intel. It's a 4 CPUs, 10-core, 40 cores, hyper-threaded 80 threads, and 1 terabyte. Yeah, I know, we went overboard over here, but what can you do? I didn't expect. So I'm running Hyper-V. I will give you my environment. This is a Hyper-V running. I have five VMs. I'll show you even the Hyper-V. There it is. Come on. Oh, no, I'm sorry. It's in roles. Okay, so I have five VMs running over here. One is my Hadron Server 1. That's my Active Directory and controller because it's all AD over here. And then I have four VMs, Server 2, 3, 4, and 5. These are the four VMs, the four servers that are going to be part of my virtual environment. So I try to clean it up and make sure I'm starting really from square one. I'm going to use number 5 as my host. So the first thing you have to do when you establish a high availability scenario is to create a cluster, as we said. So I'm going to the server manager, and I'm going to go down to the features. And you see I have a failover cluster manager, which has no cluster. So I'm going to create a new cluster. So the first name is always on SRV2. Let me do the copy and paste here. So I'm adding that. It found it. I'm adding number 3. I'm adding number 4. And the last one. No control V anymore. I'm adding that. Okay, so I have four servers that want them to be part of the same cluster. The next one is I'm going to give it a name, any name. So I'm going to call it, let's say, always on cluster. Next. Next. Done. Simple. Are we crossing our fingers? Things will come back. I'm sorry? You mean for those servers to be part of the cluster? Not special requirements. I mean, the only thing we require right now is to be Windows 2008 R2 with Service Pack 1. Other than that, that's it. As far as hardware, no, I don't have any hardware requirements. They can be, in my case, I assume they are four servers, standalone, non-share storage, no, nothing. I mean, actually, even the VMs have different RAM and different disk sizes. Yeah, they can be totally independent. Okay, so I have my cluster created. There it is. Let's see if all the nodes. I'm glad you asked this question because now I hope the nodes are ready. Nice and green, very good. If some of them are red the first time you're creating your cluster, don't panic, don't open the cigarette pack and all that. You know, it's doing it. Now, after 5 minutes pass and it's still red, okay, that's no good. Drop it and do it again. But so far, it's been working charming, no problem. Okay, so after I added the cluster, then what you have to do is, and again, a security thing, you have to go on each server and enable, there is a new tab, it's called Always On High Availability. You see this tab? And magically, it knows, because we already created, this server is part of a cluster that is called Always On CL. Okay? So I'm going to enable this baby. And of course, we want you to restart that. It's a one-time deal. So let me do it quickly for all of them. Now, another debate was if we should just have that somehow automatically available. I'll show you the PowerShell story. My PowerShell should have worked as well, but it seems we changed something in the API. I need to find the new name. So I'm restarting this one too. If you don't do that, when you try to set up the high availability, it will give you a warning. It will tell you that it's not available. Okay, one more, and we're done. As far as low-level performance, like on a page level, I would say they're very similar. Same, yeah. As far as distances, latencies, I think we have better compression, better understanding of the transaction scope. We have the contained database. We have the availability groups. We have other entities. But as far as the physical layer, I would say we're very similar. Very similar. Cheaper, hopefully, than an EMC replication. All right, so assuming I've done everything right over here, all the servers are ready to be part of my always-on. So in Denali, you have a new item under management. It's called always-on high availability. You see that? So I'm sitting now on server number 2, and I'm connected also to server 3, 4, and 5. As you can see, server 3, and the same way with 4 and 5, they don't have any user databases at all. So I'm treating server 2 as my primary, and then 3 and 4 will be my synchronous replicas, and number 5 will be my asynchronous replica. So you can do that all in one pass. So I'm going to number 2, and I say new availability. Okay, this is where you go manual, but as we said, we have a nice wizard. And we're going to call that any name you like, AVND, Availability Group, and that's my initials. But you can give any name you like. Now, I'm going to choose 2 databases because I want my Availability Group to have 2. It's the famous Adventures Works database, and I have an Adventures Works reference. And as you can see combined, I mean, it's not huge, but it's not tiny. It's about 1 gigabyte of data I want to move across. So I'm selecting the 2 databases, and that creates my availability group. It can be all 5 of them. It can be only 1. But that is my unit is going to replicate and go move across. Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. Twenty? Well, how do you know that? So the answer is today the tested number of availability groups maximum is 20. Yeah. So in my case, I'm creating 1 availability group to manage these 2 databases across 4 servers. So server 2 initial role is going to be primary, and I'm going to allow 2 failover and up to 2, and it's going to be synchronous. But this is the primary, so that's a read-write anyhow. Number 3 is going to be a secondary, and it's going to be an automatic failover. When it's automatic failover, it's automatically synchronous as well. Otherwise, it cannot be automatic failover. I'm going to add another replica, number 4. That only 1 automatic failover pair can be. We cannot have 3. But we can have 3 for synchronous. So I want this one to be synchronous as well for reporting reasons. And number 5, I run out of synchronous. It's going to be by default asynchronous, but it's going to be part of my disaster recovery probably. So it's asynchronous. And then in my scenario, this is kind of the replication style. You can have the database already restored when you just join the databases, or I can do like in my case for the demo full, where it's going to do a backup of the 2 databases and then restore and then establish the whole high availability. So I'm going to do a full. It's going to do a bunch of checks. First obstacle passed. Don't laugh. Things change here. Next. Okay, here's my script. And here we hit them the details too, but let's see the details. The critical part is to pass this one, I found out. Create availability group A, G, and D. If that passes, things are happy. Come on, pass. Yay. So we're restoring over here, creating a full backup. It's fast, so give it 1 minute. So, but in real life, you know, probably if you have a large database, you're going to restore, backup the database, restore the database, and then join those databases. It depends the size. But it's not, doesn't take long because this is a compressed database backup, and then we do the restore, so things are pretty fast. I have one more to restore. Yes. You see, I not only the backup, I'm doing the log as well. So it takes the backup, then it takes the log, make sure everything is all done. So I'm all successful here. Woo! You see, I'm in a restoring state over here. All in every server, and I believe by now this should go already to synchronized. Why is it synchronized and not synchronizing? This is says synchronized, this is says synchronized. I see you're all eager to get more envelopes here. This one says synchronizing. So who's going to raise them? Raise your hand and tell me why one is synchronized, the other is synchronizing. Not you. Yes, sir? Not backup. You're almost there. Asynchronous replication versus synchronous replication. Let me throw you a little USB. So synchronized, this is the synchronous, always on, let's call it by that, like that. It's fully synchronized, it's there. Synchronizing, asynchronous, by its concept, is never synchronized. It's always, in theory, trying to catch up. Now, there is a state synchronized in asynchronous as well. If you query the database, maybe this was a snapshot, it can reach synchronized level, but mostly synchronizing, because it's trying to catch up. Okay, so there it is. We have four nodes on a cluster, synchronized, two asynchronous, one asynchronous. 5 minutes. Good stuff. So you may say, so how do we use this thing now? Good question. So we have written two clients, which I'm sure they're going to be like another Adventure Works soon. This is my OLTP client in a way, and this is my reporting client. And you can see that, I hope, from the title. This says OLTP, this says reporting. And down here I have my connection string, which we're going to play with. I'm going to remove this failover partner. Failover partner is a remaining from the mirroring, which we don't need right now. So I'm going to change this one, and you see on top I'm connecting on server 2. Can you guys see it in the back or is it really unreadable? It's okay? I'm glad. Because I found out zooming with a remote desktop connection doesn't work too well. I don't know if you've done that. My main desktop somehow zooms, but anyhow. So OLTP here is to create, add a bunch of factors. That's what it does. And reporting is just reading from that. So here's the same connection string we're going to talk about. They're both having the same connection string. And they're both connecting hard-coded to server 2. So this one starts adding rows. There it is. And this one is reading rows. And you see, since they're both reading from the same server, same table, things are happy. Now, let's start with the hard-coded stuff. I'm going to change the connection here to number 3. This thing changed. And we're getting an error. And the error says, which is the, I did that in purpose, by the way, this cannot be accessed because it's not available for queries. So what you have to do is I have to go to my availability group, and I'll make it faster, and this is where you'll make it active. Hmm. one level down. Oh, sorry, wrong server. I'm not in the primary. Whew, I thought we had a new feature. So I'm going read intent only. So everyone I wanted, and you don't have to do all of them, but just for our demo here. So I'm saying okay. So here's my, again, OLTP connecting to server 2. This is to server 3. Now when I connect to server 3, nothing happens. Ah, I know why. Because we haven't actually made the read intent. Okay. So hopefully now, there it is. We're connecting on server 3. It is a read-only. So I'm in two different servers now, server 2, server 3. So I'm inserting now on server 2. I'm reading from server 3. See the numbers? And I stop that. And then eventually that goes to the same number. So this is two servers, fully in sync, but with the slight delay. And you need to factor in the display delay as well. This is remote desktop. But this is having two servers, full in sync, one inserting, the other is updating the system. Because of the interest of time, because I think I have only 2 minutes left, wish I had more. There is the connection string I was telling you is over here. You would change, let me make this one a little bigger so you can see it. This is the one we added in Denali. There is an application intent equal read-only. The reason it didn't work before, because my connection string didn't have that. It was looking for a read-only, period. So I changed mine to be read-only. If I change them to be read-only intent, then your connection string needs that connection, this element. By having that, the system knows where to connect and how to connect. And to do that, you would have to create that new listener we said. You would go over here. I don't have a listener automatically. You go in over here and you add the listener, and by default it's AGND listener. There is a port, there is a network mode, dynamic HP, and then it chooses a subnet, and it can be any subnet. In case, in my case, is my subnet. So when this one connects, takes a minute or so. The idea over here is, as you see here, my data source becomes AGND listener. You're not using anymore the server name, you're using the listener name. So having the listener name in place, the last thing you have to do is, and we'll put it in the GUI, not to worry, but today in CTP3, you have to run a little code to establish all this process. So if I have an availability group, I call it AGND, I say that my server 4 is a secondary role, and it assumes this is the routing. Server 5 is my secondary role, but most importantly, my server 2, which is the primary role, it has this read-only routing list. It has number 4 and number 5. So when I use the listener to connect to this availability group, which is AGND, these kind of rules take place. So which one is the primary? SR server 2. Which one is one of the secondaries? Can be server 4 or server 5. If server 4 goes down, based on the last statement, server 5 automatically will assume the role of read 5, be the server that reads from. So three components. Create your availability after you did the cluster, have the availability group, have the availability group listener, and then you establish in here some rules of routing lists. This will be part of the GUI as well. We don't have it yet, but it will be one of them to show the order of changes. So after all this happens, this is where you're changing, you know, the connection strings, and things should happen just fine. I have 1 minute left. Is that right? Yes. No. No, you have to change that manually if you need that. Actually, the replication is not a hub. It's not, like a circle. It's a hub and spoke. So you have one primary and three secondaries. If this secondary becomes the primary, the other two remaining, they become in part of the circle. Now, how they connect with each other, that's something you have to maybe reestablish. No, the new primary will replicate to them. Yep. Now, it's always hub and spoke scenario. Yeah. Yes. So the last question: this listener is available only for the always-on scenario. So you have to have a topology of always on to be used. We will publish a simple way to migrate an existing mirror to always on. No, still mirroring is supported as is today, 100%. No problem. Yes, when you have a mirroring by itself, it's read-only. Yep. To have it readable, you have to use always on technology. Okay, because we have the listener, we have all this other infrastructure there. All right, any other questions? Yes, sir.
Sorry,
the question is if the always on is available in standard edition. My guess is not. To be determined, actually, more exactly. We haven't finalized yet the feature list per version. It might be to maybe we support only two nodes in a standard, my guess, but I wouldn't know. I think we're beta 3 now, so maybe by the end of the year we'll know better the packaging of that. Yeah. So, you like this feature? Easy to use? It's very easy, guys. If you've been through clustering hell and all that, I mean, this is very easy stuff. Works very well, and we struggled a lot to make sure it's transparent on the application. There has been a lot of work done to work through the listener, make the connection string once, and then have the system manage how you switch over. So CTP3, probably you know by now, CTP3 of Denali is publicly available. If you want to download it, download it. As you can see, having a few VMs in Hyper-V works just fine. If you want to test it, establish some VMs, set up your always-on, try that, give us feedback. We still have a few months to finalize this product. Hopefully you like it and you take good advantage of it. All right? Thank you very much. Thank you for coming. I'll see you next time.